earned him the title Father of the Nation. Mahatma Gandhi is more than an individual. He's a movement that still exists today in the hearts of the people. Rabindranath Tagore once said, Mahatma Gandhi came and stood at the door of India's destitute millions, clad as one of themselves, speaking to them in their own language. Who else has so unreservedly accepted the vast masses of the Indian people as his flesh and blood? Truth, awaken truth. We welcome you to the One Day National Conference on.
Friends from the media, Doordarshan, students and religious persons. It's taking me a minute to stabilize my emotion as I haven't been able to go to this college for 40 years.
Both of them, Zoom was there.
And This is the story of an ordinary, very ordinary student turning to leadership. I won't say extraordinary, but very leadership. The point I'm making, because many of you are freshers, I'm sure, the first year, second, third, masters, I do not know. But when I last, my rush to the college was, I was asked to come to the principal's office because we had made students, very, very ordinary students. We loved our studies, much less than liked our extracurricular activities. And the little research we did on the Mahatma and women's empowerment. Because there are several contrary views about every great man. But in this sense, as I went through it, I said, I think my schooling, my college, my destiny, my challenges, my work with very poor women has definitely helped us imbibe it without knowing it. So when you put everything together, it's simply amazing. Let me start. As we stand on the threshold of celebrating the 150th Gandhi Jayanti, it is momentous that his name is a byword globally, owned by all the world for the values he stood for, an apostle of peace, satyagraha and ahimsa. Lauding him, our country is often referred to as the land of the Mahatma. The status of women in India has been subject to many upheavals and changes over the past few years, a few centuries I would say, from equal status with men in the ancient period, through the meso-level stagnation in the medieval period, to the promotion of equal rights by several reformers, including the Mahatma. Of course, our constitutional reforms of post-independence and regulatory legal systems provide a further transformation of women's status, both at the home and the workplace. Mahatma Gandhi is indeed the tallest of the reformers, with the impact that has been most significant for women in independent India. In the history of women's leadership in modern India, women have adorned high offices, including the President, the Prime Minister, the Speaker of the Lok Sabha, the Leader of the Opposition, etc. In fact, the historical related goes to reformers like the Mahatma, as they involved masses of poor women into the political movements, especially during many of the satyagrahas. The Mahatma worked not only for the political emancipation of the nation, but for the liberation of all suppressed and oppressed sections of society. One of the noteworthy results of his lifetime work has been the mass awakening of women that made them shed their deep-rooted sense of inferiority, rights to dignity and self-esteem en masse in the movement for liberation of the country from the colonial yoke. Women poor, urban and rural, educated and uneducated, Indian and foreign, are attracted to his ideas and beliefs as it is today. Indeed, Gandhian thoughts is universally applicable today more than ever before. And I'd like to come back and connect with my young audience. The key words of this decade, let me remind you currently, are minimalist, frugal, mindfulness, raw diets, fasting, meditation, exercise. All the practices of the Mahatma that are relevant today in terms of food, that is eating locally, a fad today. Gandhiji's favorite meal I'd like to share with you was wheat sprouts, greens, almonds, lemon and honey. Whenever he took it, he turned to fasting, not to doctors. Doing one's own work or spinning by forms of yoga, exercise, while non-ostentation, meditation to declutter the mind were followed by him. Recycling, eco-friendly, khadi, the natural organic meat that's taking the nation by and the world by storm, all are relevant today. Therefore, I think today that many of the things that I'm talking about, I have begun to practice over the last decade. And this is a sort of sense of discipline and decluttering the mind, as I say. It's very useful because it's not because not only what the Mahatma said, but in changing one's own self-discovery and progression, I think these are very, very useful techniques that people are using all over the world in the last 2 decades. Sustainability and self-sufficiency, peace, environment protection, were solutions. If the rule that follows that to avoid these, we need an economy and a way of life based on limited means, voluntary and happy acceptance of frugality and commitment to non-violence. Thus, in Gandhian vision, we have a framework in which a wide base for realizing the most objective, the most important objective of peace and environment protection can be realized. At the same time, meeting the needs of all people, meaning poverty reduction. The most defining feature of the 21st century is that there is nothing less than a survival crisis, caused by a number of serious environmental problems on the one hand, and accumulations of weapons of mass destruction on the other. As the world grows without much hope, with an increasing sense of futility for the leadership to find solutions for these pressing problems before it is too late, because we know what happened in the last 2 world wars. Genuine hope can emerge if there are strong grassroots efforts for peace and environment protection, as envisaged by Gandhiji. I'll tell you a bit about our work with sister introduced. So after traversing from Stella Maris and going further and all over, one of the things I was left in legacy was, and I have been working very closely over the past few decades, is our own mass movement of poor women. It's a grassroots movement similar to Gandhian ethics, ethos and ethics. The Working Women's Forum and the Indian Cooperative Network of Women, that unfortunately has 600,000 women workers, very poor from the informal economy, in the 3 states of southern India. And many of them, even today, most of them are hawkers and vendors, silk weavers, artisans, lace makers, people who did not know where the next meal was coming. But after 40 years, we're going to touch our half a century soon, that due to our continuous inputs, such as loaning, we reached at 450 or 500 crores of rupees, and at a 99% repayment. Unlike the non-performing assets that you are hearing today, these are very poor women, but very good at repaying, and the whole organization is off by and for women. We do not have many men in the organization. And these very poor women, so you can find a vice president as somebody who came from a fish farmer's background or a laborer. So the story is as what Mahatma Gandhi would have said if he was alive: self-sufficiency, self-help, and leadership to be built. So it's going to take a little time. This is not an MBA course, but they learn by experimenting. So a wide range of services such as training in financial literacy, leadership, empowerment, healthcare, skill, vocational awareness workshops, apart from micro-insurance of a variety of varieties, and also in terms of the gender awareness and cooperative consciousness, because we are also part cooperative. So what we have found is the 276 occupations that we work. Emphasis is on direct participation of the poor women in all programs, governance, transparency, digitalization, software. Everything needs to be transparent for the last 20 years, and they get space to learn and to be up to the level of the vice president. Because I see that it's unfortunate that at the level of the president, it will take some time, because we are not facilitators, but the environment, like banks, government offices, etc., require all the time English education, particular type of skills, literacy, etc. So therefore, these are the barriers of the environment to their leadership, not within themselves. As writers, they are absolutely fantastic. Now, what we think is that Gandhian thought of local entrepreneurship and self-governance by poor women is what we in practice. So I just wanted to bring to your notice that this is what our work is, and I thank the Stella Maris College, my sisters, for having thought of me as an important role model. And I must also tell you that I have spoken I was at the United Nations recently, spoken to their Secretary General, and today Madras has become, due to the Indian Cooperative Network for Women, the Mecca for cooperatives and women worldwide and globally. I tell you why. The two largest unions in the world, the International Raiffeisen Union, after 50 years chose us and me, and the first time as a woman on their board, that there are Swiss bankers and others, and we are a four women bank. Secondly, the International Cooperative Alliance, which is the second union, also has us and me as a office bearer. In the last 50 years, this is most noteworthy, they have never had a woman office bearer simultaneously on both the boards. It's a great appreciation for the Working Women's Forum and the Indian Cooperative Network for Women, which Madam Hillary Clinton, as Secretary of State, even visited. So therefore, and they came to learn, and many of the world leaders have admired what these poor women have done, and the context is very clear. This is very simple, these are very poor people, these are learning the governance, and the systems are poor, and it's minimalist, frugal, even the cost overheads are very, very less. And they have, I must be proud to tell you, that the Indian Cooperative Network for Women has doubled its outstanding loans within 5 years, doubled into 450 to 500 crores. So therefore, this is all the value education that institutions such as Stella Maris provide, or the socializing that one gets. And my mother, who passed away 6 weeks ago or 2 months ago, Dr. Jayaranachan, was a legend. Padmashri Jayaranachan was a legendary social worker who I had the occasion to observe at home and outside. Now, what was Gandhi's perception of women? They're competitors. Then he says, the wife is not the husband's slave, but his companion and his helpmate, and an equal partner in all his joys and sorrows, as free as the husband to choose her path. I'm just giving you a few quotes from him before I go on. He also said that about Kasturba, though there have been a lot of other details written about their relationship, it is because of her that I'm today what I am, his wife. To quote Gandhi, when he talked against social ills, he said, it is good to swim in the waters of tradition, but to sink in them is suicidal. Similarly, if you look at the marriage extravaganza, he also had much to say. The dowry system he considered heartless. His view of intercaste marriage, we all know, was he urged people to solemnize between the children of God, and the upper caste females. Now, Gandhi's perception on widows was also similar in terms of the parda. He said for him, the parda system was no less than a vicious, brutal, and barbarous practice towards women, that is seclusion. On his view on the Devadasi system, I'm only talking to you about gender and gender violence, which feminists and humanists are taking up today. And we are talking about the 1930s and 40s, nearly a century today. You know, the like Subramanya Bharati. You know, these were the reformers that could bring up the issue from a humanitarian point of view, not as a feminist activist. But I would say he was a feminist activist. Today, we do not have these pronouncements as clearly as we did then. Now, on the Devadasi system, I think many of you know where women were dedicated to the temples. He took care of the pathetic conditions of the child Devadasis, and he felt that it was important for them to guard their honor as women. According to Gandhi, one of the first tasks that he took was to work for the abolition of the Devadasi or temple women. Gandhi against gender-based discrimination. He says, I fail to see any reason for jubilation over the birth of a son and for mourning over the birth of a daughter. Both are God's gifts. They have an equal right to live and are equally necessary to keep the world going. He also said on share of property, it's a very, very important point for many of us, you know that we come through experiences where poor women's property is taken and the older women do not get it. And our own sisters are, and most of the cases we hear in the courts are between siblings. So here he says, a daughter's share must be equal to that of a son. The husband's earnings are the joint property of husband and wife as he makes money for her assistance. Now,
men and women exercise the need by nature and seem with human eyes. Gandhi preached and practiced sharing of household by both men and women of the family, a big issue for us in terms of gender-based violence, because we think that the sharing of household